going to begin our next session. The chair for this session is Dr. Kaveri, faculty at MCPH. And I request Kaveri to please call the speaker on the stage.
Hello, I'm very pleased to be chairing this session with Meera because of my interests also in environment and urbanization essentially. So I'd very briefly introduce Dr. Meera. Dr. Meera Bayandu is assistant professor here at the Manipal Center for Philosophy and Humanities. She teaches Indian philosophy, Indian traditions of thought and knowledge, environmental humanities and environmental philosophy. Her academic work is amply supported by her practical experience working with village communities in the Himalayas on environment and sustainability issues and traditional studies in Indian philosophy and yoga. She has published extensively on these subjects. Her publications include a forthcoming book called Nature in Indian Philosophy and Culture, which is to be published by Springer, and peer-reviewed chapters in several books and articles in several journals, including the Journal of Cultural Geography, Sarai Reader, the Indian Journal of Eco-Criticism, etc. So I'm very pleased to invite Meera to come and give you a talk. So she's going to, the title of her talk is Geography and Place in Jaina Dharma, a discussion on Jambudvipa Samagrahini.
Sangrahini.
Jambudvipa Sangrahini.
That should have an E, sorry.
Jambudvipa.
It
should have been Jambudvipa.
Just pick the. I think we will give that.
It is Jambudvipa.
I think we'll give that controversial subject a big break because I'm not a Sanskritist in training. So I am basically an environmental philosopher, work on place studies. So with due apologies for all the spellings.
It's correct.
I think I copied it from the book, so you can challenge the author of the translator. Okay. So one of the things is that I would like to first of all put myself a caveat. And I know there are a lot of learned scholars of Jainism here. This is my one of my first forays into Jainism. So there are a lot of things that maybe that I will not be able to answer as an expert. It's also a work in progress. Because my entry into Jainism is through environment, is through nature. So my first work on Jainism, which I actually included a section on my book, which is about the Jaina Dharma of living beings and how they classify the living beings, and then followed by the kind of ethical principles they have towards living beings. I think there was a book called Jainism and Ecology by Ted Chappell, edited by Ted Chappell, which I first came across. And what interested me was the concept of the human, non-human, which is very different in Jainism as compared to other places, because for the first time I saw a philosophical system that was putting, that allowed for, that actually did not insist on rationality as a means of liberation. In the sense, non-human beings, Jaina souls, if I'm right, can also attain moksha. Their penultimate birth need not be human. Which is very, it can be apparently, we'll take these questions to the experts at the end, but that is what Panika says in his book, and so does Anand Kumar Swami talk about it. But that was my first interest. Of course, I didn't go deep into it. I only looked at the categories of the human and the non-human and the different classifications of Tiryancha and the sense, number of sense being one sense, two sense, five sense, where human beings have the rational sense. And about Shravana, how you can listen to spiritual truths and therefore get liberation. So then somebody suggested that I am interested in geography, so I got a letter saying, look at this text. So when I first started reading the text, it was very funny to me. The first reaction that you get on reading the text is, it's basically such a detail, they don't leave any loose ends. Such a detailed description, mathematical description of geography. So I will be reading some passages to give you a sense of what it happens when a person suddenly encounters this text. And for a long time, I was very puzzled. So I wrote just a brief description and said, this is what it is. Then as I started going into it, I found that the text had more to it than just the description. Like I asked the question, like all philosophers do, why was this text ever written? And what is the context in which this text is? And then I realized that the text is not a singular entity, but it's among a corpus of other texts. And so that begins my first foray into looking at geography, and it's a work in progress. I will be glad of references, suggestions that you people could give me so that I can make it even better. Thank you. So, so these are some of the facts that are given. The text that I'm using is critically edited text translated with the commentary of Prabhananda Suri by Frank van den Bosch, who's a German, and its first edition is came out in 2007. It's quite recently published, but I'm sure the text actually has a very good introduction about who this Haribhadra Suri is, because there are so many Haribhadras in Jaina, as authors, and so there are there's also one who wrote the Shaddarshana Sutra. So he does such a good complex analysis. I am very satisfied with the analysis, and he concludes that this was somewhere written in the 12th century. It's in Prakrit, it's in Maharashtri, the dialect of Prakrit. There are two themes that I've identified in this. So it's one of the minor texts related to a larger corpus of texts dealing with geography and cosmography. As mentioned in the introduction to the critical text by Frank von Bosch, the text has to be viewed as an essential part of the doctrine of Jainism. In this paper, rather than analyze the text itself in detail, and its surrounding controversies, I've heard that there are controversies. I haven't been able to lay hands on all the arguments regarding the text, so I will not try and address them at this point. Maybe at a later stage, I will add that to my paper. I will instead focus on the underlying presumptions and implications of geography and cosmography for Jaina thought. In my earlier work on Jaina geography related to an aspect of nature in Indian thought, I described the text as being important for Jaina based on soteriological concerns, that is the moksha dharma, because it's important for moksha. Here I will seek to extend this argument. There are basically two broad themes this paper will address. One theme, as a cultural geographer, I'm looking at the geographical perspectives, and it will be a descriptive part of my paper, which will address the way Jaina cosmography is detailed, particularly the idea of shapes, forms, numerical descriptions, and geographical classifications. The second theme, which is largely speculative, and here I'm taking a leap of imagination, will address the connection between liberation and place, therefore making a claim for the importance of cosmographical texts like Jambudvipa, I'll call it JDS from now on, within the Jaina thought. So connecting the description of our middle world, which is called Jambudvipa, to the larger cosmic imagination of the Jainas, and plus a lot of rich, you can see the background image there, there's a lot of rich artwork, which is diagrammatic representations which have taken place in many tricks. I would love to go through all these diagrams and look at all the texts. It's one of those, it's a lifetime project to look at the sacred geography of particularly illustrated texts, almost like there's these texts have very rich illustrations, and the way they use geometry and circles and squares, I'm sure we're going to have a presentation on Jaina mathematics soon. So they are concerned a lot with numbers. This is a footnote so that people are familiar. When I talk about numbers, they were concerned with both measuring time and measuring space, and they had very particular measurement numbers. And this is not only for about the Jains, but a lot of other traditions of intellectual thought also use the same numbers, but the Jainas were very precise. And without going into the other professor's talk, I would like to say that they have a full classificatory chart of numbers. They have peculiar categories like innumerable number, infinite numbers, and finite numbers, and square roots and axial roots, and particularly a very rich source of calculations and traditions inside that. I'll give you a couple of examples from this text, which also has a lot of numerical calculations. The point is that we don't know whether they're actually factual and they'll match on to the empirical world calculations, but the very fact that they're able to abstract and talk about it is a sort of an exercise in rationality and mathematical thought, which is very interesting for me as a student of the study of science. Okay, so if you note the thing, it says 6 finger breadth is equal to 1 pada, 2 pada is equal to 1 vihatti or visati, 2 vihatti is 1 rayani. Rayani is equal to 1 kuchi, 2 rayanis are equal to 1 kuchi, which is about, you know, 1/3 of a 6 feet danda. A danda is equal to 200 dandas are 1 gauva, and 4 gauvas is equal to 1 yojana, and yojana is about 9.09 miles, I think it's 1.5 kilometers or so. So, there's another measurement which is called the Raju, which I'll talk of. The Yojana and Raju are used to measure large cosmic distances, and for micro distances we use Danda is usually used to measure the depth of rivers and other stuff. The Vitati, Raju, Kuchi and all are measurements which are used in your everyday trade and measuring out. For they would use Danda and Kuchi to measure house measurements and all. So they were basically using it functionally, whichever suits it. You're not going to use Yojana to build a house, you're going to use. But if you want to describe Brahma's palace, you would use Yojana. If you want to describe cosmos, you would use Raju. Raju is the largest measurement. And So the description of Jambudvipa occurs within a larger cosmic description of the Jaina cosmos. The Jaina universe is a bounded universe of worlds within a medium where movement of souls is possible. So this is the first thing that you come across, is that in cosmography, the Jaina universe is a kind of a bubble of a bounded universe. There is something where cosmic worlds are possible, that is living beings and non-living beings and matter and all that is possible. So this is a real world, and there's a bounded universe beyond which what some people refer to as aloka or non-world space is there, some emptiness. They do not pay so much attention to emptiness, though Anand Kumar Swami makes a point that he talks a lot about the aloka and says maybe it's like the Buddha Shunya. But it's actually, if you look at the Jaina text, there's no reference to this as much as the reference to the bounded universe. So the bounded universe has medium where the souls can move. So movement is possible within a medium. Earlier representations of the cosmos in early Jaina literature were through images of a boat, a drum, you can see it looks like one of those Rudra Damarus, and then or through the idea of a symbol, which is the one, the taal that we use for hitting. So it's like a disc, right? It's not a disc particularly, it's like a discus, the one that you throw. So those were some of the images that they used to represent, those were the geometrical shapes of representing the universe. Later, I think this would be 12th or 13th century onwards, you find influences of the world being represented as a cosmic person. I can speculate here and say this is a very common theme in many Brahminical texts like the Vedas and the Loka Purusha, but definitely the cosmic person also has got some sacred geographical component from the Tantra as well as the Vaishnava traditions. They have this cosmic person idea. So this is one of the pamphlets that is given to us when we go for a Jaina class in a local ashram. So they'll give us these pamphlets and they'll explain to you. The whole of the worlds are divided into what we call the lowermost point, which you call as Urdhva Loka.
Okay,
you can see that. Left one. So that is the lower regions still here, and those lower regions are called Adholoka. Then you have the Madhya Loka, the middle region, and then you have the upper regions, which are the heavens. If you notice here, the person has translated it as ropes, 7 Raju. 6.5 Raju, 6 Raju, 5, then 4, 2.5 and 1 rope. This is where we all are. Okay, and here's the measurement of the distance in terms of Yojana. This is the width and this is the height. And then symmetrically speaking, on the top you have 1 rope, 3.5, 5, 3.5, 1. From this image you can actually see that they had so much of emphasis on symmetry. And there's one thing that is very common to all the descriptions of all these standing vertical structures is that the base is always larger than the top. Because they almost as if they are drawing from architecture where they know if you have a narrow base, the things will topple over. So they have this conception that the base of the cosmos also should be like broader than its top. So that's one thing that I, the important thing for them, now why would they go and put out this large cosmos? First of all, if you have like 64 million, is it right, Soniji? 64 million types of living being on, and I don't know, different texts have different numbers. But, 84 million types of living beings. And you need place for all of them to stay. So you have to create a universe which can sustain and hold all of them. So I think the imagination, the cosmos, comes from saying, okay, now that we have this many creatures, we have to describe the ecosystem or the niches where they have to stay. And so they invented this, they kind of imagined this lokas where all these beings would stay. Whether it's plants or animals. So let me now talk a little bit about this measure called Rajju. It's interesting the way the Rajju is defined. I take this from Panikkar's book, where he has described it easily for me to understand. The Jaina cosmos is measured by a large measure called a string or a Rajju. This is defined this way. The distance covered by a perfected being in 6 months as it rises upward at the speed of 2 million yojanas per kshana or second. So there's this cosmic being. Swamiji gave a very useful example of a rocket. So imagine a cosmic being is a rocket and he drops his payload of karma and escapes into the upper air. And as he's going at a very perfect speed. It's also a special kind of travel which I now have to study. It's called no touching travel. So they're kind of going at enormous fast speeds, okay? And this being is going and he's traveling for 6 months at the speed of 2 million yojanas per second. And that's sort of faster than even the neural transmitter, if I can make a comparison. So he's going at that speed and that's one Rajju. And I think that Digambara and Swetambara differ. One says 14 strings tall are cosmoses. The other cosmos is 15 strings tall. I'm not sure because I found two references. So let's take it as about 15 strings high for one of the Jains. In terms of time, so if a perfected being started out in the lowermost scale and started moving upward, then he would cover the entire cosmos in one end to another in about 7.5 years at the rate of, remember, 2 million yojanas per second. So it's not, it's just not a, so that's the bounded cosmos. So if you think the cosmos is a little box in which we are bound, it's not. It's very infinite, very large, very huge. So just think of the Jaina mind conceptualizing these large numbers and visualizing these large distances in terms of some kind of measurement. And that for me is a very interesting idea. Just to imagine an infinite cosmos and just think of, they wanted to say maybe this is how much time it takes. Or maybe they took the canons and something in what Mahavira said or the Tattvata Sutra said, they have saying they said, therefore it must be true. But the whole imagination of this kind of speed and the kind of measuring distances through movement or travel itself starts to give me a clue that place is central to Jaina thought in more ways than one. The other important thing is the whole of the all of these things are held together like a wheel and axle. There are five Merus actually holding down this cosmos like axles. The one that is in the center of our universe is called the Sudarshana Meru. It's the main Meru, which is in the center of the island. You can see that little yellow spot over there. So in common with other, I quote here, John quote, in common with other Indic cosmologies, the Jainas conceive of a universe as centered around the axial Mount Meru. This large mountain at the very center of the universe serves as both the hub for human realms that spread out from it horizontally and the vertical axis that links the human realm with those of the infernal beings below and heavenly beings above. You can think of it like a top or like a like one of those, you know, the children put those little round, they put the pegs into the pillar and they put it in. And so it's almost like there's a Meru, and all these worlds are kind of linked axially through the Mount Meru, and they're like wafers which are forming these different worlds of different sizes and shapes. The island of Jambudvipa, Dvipa because it's an island, is centrally placed and it is surrounded by a salty ocean. The other continents are ringed around, so they are rings, but Jambudvipa is a central island which is sort of flattish like a disc. It's not as much as a plate as it is a discus, because it is it has got the Meru is kind of, it's more like a top shape, right? The if the Lavana Ocean is the thing, you can see that it's labeled very well. There are each of these in around the Meru, there are two east-west rivers and two north-south rivers, and all these rivers actually divide the continent into six parts. So there are some mountain ranges which divide the continent, and there are some rivers which divide the, so each of the rivers is divided. And this is a quite a modern representation. It's not an old representation. The old representations are a little more difficult to decipher. But the whole idea of putting it as a symmetrical universe is very common in, so if there's something, and also as a mirror image. The Jaina texts that are very descriptive of the geography of the landscape of the middle worlds that human beings inhabit with other kinds of beings. These are somewhat secular descriptions of landscape of the great disc island called the Jambudvipa, the island of the rose apple tree, stone apple tree, or Indian blackberry. There are many various ways. Nobody has agreed on what that jambu is. These are very highly imaginative. Kort describes this Jambudvipa in this way in his book on iconographies in world religions. So he says, Narratives of Icons and Idols in Jain History, he talks about this. He says, the middle range of the universe in the part which humans can live is a thin horizontal slice of the cosmos that extends out for a finite, nearly unimaginable distance. This wafer consists of a series of concentric continents surrounded and divided by oceans. Each continent is twice as wide as the preceding one. The humans live on the innermost continent, the Jambudvipa, in the center. It is one continent that is a circle, that's not a ring. These descriptions I find are not a story narrative like that we find in Vedas and other places. When we have the same kind of geographical narratives in Hindu, for example, let us say we are looking at, let's say, the description of the earth in the Mahabharata, or we're looking at other texts which describe geography, the geography is always linked to a sacred narrative. So they always talk about the geography in terms of what happened to people over there. So if you look at the Himalayas, it is where Shiva lives, or somewhere where Sati's body fell down, or a river comes out of Brahma's Kamandal. So the whole idea of the creation of the universe, and particularly in, from the Vedic texts and the Brahminical traditions, Hindu traditions, is about stories. So stories make landscape and make them Indra cut down the wings of the mountain, it fell. The Jainas don't have any agency of the gods or anything in creating this. This universe existed and will exist, and there is also a reality about it. So their descriptions are more secular. So that was something interesting I found, that they don't have, they have later stories about temples and where they were born, but the landscape pre-exists before the stories happen. So in Indian narratives of sacred landscape, I found that the stories make up the landscape. They actually construct the landscape for us. The cosmic geography is described in some of the primary texts like the Jaina Agamas, and also in smaller texts like Jambudvipa Sangrini. The point is there are detailed descriptions of directions, sizes, the area of the cosmos. There are some other texts which I intend to slowly look at on Jaina geography. Now I started with the Jambudvipa, but there is also Jambudvipa Prajnapti, and then there is Chandra Prajnapti and Surya Prajnapti, the texts which I don't have access to, which I'm hoping to get. Then there is Triloka Sara, then there is Triloka Prajnapti, and then Triloka Deepika. There's a long list of texts to study. Of course, Tattvartha Sutra, which I had, I immediately picked up and started reading. Kshetra Samasa, which I thought is a slightly newer text. And Brihat Sangrahini, which has both cosmography. And so there's a long list of texts to add to this, and slowly, hopefully, there'll be something on that. So let's look at the Jambudvipa Sangrahini itself. It begins by describing various regions, mountains, and rivers, naming them with certainty, with very accurate descriptions of distance and directions in the form of sutra, the commentary. The commentary begins with, of course, a prayer to Mahavira, who's a teacher of teachers. And this person says, Hariputra says, I'm writing this for myself and for others. The first question you will start asking as a philosopher is, why is he writing it for himself? I mean, the question is, what is this? He's saying, usually when we say, I'm writing this for moksha, I'm writing this so people get enlightened and all. So he says, I'm writing it for myself and for others. And that as a philosopher intrigued me. Was he making notes and then he decided to publish it? Or was he studying a text? It seems like that, that he was studying a text and he said, let me make these notes, then they'll be useful for other students too. So it almost sounds like a very humble attempt at describing. The other thing that I also think is that it's a part of the Jaina consciousness that knowledge about our universe is very, very important in the concern for moksha, which they call Samyak Jnana. And as Swamiji kept repeating in his words, you would have seen, it's important to know where we are in this world before we go. And I'll come to why it's important. It's very important for you to know at which point, where, in which time, space, continuum, where are you located. Even if you're an insignificant speck in the universe, you need to know where you're located. So your location is very important for you, particularly for the moksha. So the other thing that I also can think of is, as I was looking at ancient Indian education systems, the Jainas ran a lot of schools. They were very important after the Buddhist, big universities were run by the Buddhists, of course, we know of them. But a lot of Jaina schools and Patashalas were set up in various places. And perhaps this was a geography textbook. You know, so that is also quite possible that it was Bhugola. And if you actually look up the current, contemporarily, if you look at ABC Primer of Jainism and all, which the Jaina mats all do, they have this text under what they usually say Bhugola, geography, and they give Jaina geography as a geography text of the Jains. So it's quite possible that they were teaching them this geography, maybe doing mathematics with geography, I don't know, but it's good to think about those in this way. But the text itself just says, I'm writing it for myself and for the other person, other people. So he starts off by dividing this text into topics. Now this is not something, when an Indian text wants to talk about something, because there were oral traditions, the text had a particular structure to it. And the first structure was table of contents. You had to clearly say that these are, because you didn't have a table of contents in an oral text, you had to, in your first shloka or your second or third, somewhere along the first few shlokas, talk about what are the various topics that I'm going to discuss. And so you will usually start with a list of topics that I'm going to discuss. These are the things I'm going to discuss. So he says, I'm going to discuss the sectors, the yojanas, the continent, the world mountain regions, the peaks, the fortresses, and the rows of abodes, provinces, mountain lakes, rivers. All the sum total of this is the Sangrahini or the summary. And I'm writing for both myself and others because it is Samyakyan. So it's like a table of contents. So the list is more not a list of important or significant topics, but it's a list, it's a table of contents of the whole text. And that's very common. The text itself is very obscure because the sutras are all very small and they're probably like mnemonic devices. Without the commentary of Prabhananda Suri, you can't actually understand the text because it's very, very brief. But the commentary, particularly written, I think, in the 13th century, makes it, 13th or 14th century, makes it even more understandable or clarifies. If somebody else chose to write another commentary on it, maybe it'll turn out differently. But what we are reading is from the commentary of Prabhananda Suri. Some common themes in the Jambudvipa. Now, the geographical themes in Jambudvipa Sangrahini. First is the geometrical form and symmetry. One of the most interesting aspects of Jaina geography is the listing of numerous places and regions. Apart from naming these regions, there are lots of proper names. in the, some of them are quite empirical, we know those places exist, some of them are very unempirical, some of them are related to current geography, some of them are antiquity, and some of them may be even mythical. So these are the names. The geography is very much more, they're more interested in mathematically mapping it out according to canonical descriptions of earlier masters and teachers. So if Ganga is flowing east, it is flowing east, if the canon says so. If it is somewhere flowing west, they will not talk about it. It's very symmetrical.